My name is Sandy Lynch, and I'm the director of the Institute for Ethics and Society at the University of Notre Dame, Australia. So we welcome you to the first of two lectures, public lectures, delivered by Professor John Haldane, while he holds the position of Distinguished Visiting Professor of Philosophy at the University this semester. The University is grateful for the support of the Sydney branch of the Order of Malta in presenting these two lectures. And I'll take this opportunity to ask you to turn off your mobile phones or turn them to silent for the duration of the lecture if you've not already done so. In terms of introducing John, I wanted to tell you that in addition to his current position here, Professor Haldane holds a number of distinguished appointments. He is and has been Professor of Moral Philosophy at St Andrews University in Scotland for the past 25 years, where he directs the Centre for Ethics, Philosophy and Public Affairs. He is the inaugural Newton Raisa Senior Distinguished Chair of Philosophy at Baylor University in the United States. He is also visiting professor in the Jubilee Centre for Character and Values at Birmingham University. His achievements are recognised nationally and internationally in his role as Fellow of the Royal Society of Edinburgh, Fellow of the Royal Society of Arts, and Chairman of the Royal Institute of Philosophy, London. In 2005, Professor Haldane was appointed by Pope Benedict XVI as consultor to the Pontifical Council for Culture. He is also a member of the Pontifical Academy of Thomas Aquinas and of the Pontifical Academy for Life. In the interests of beginning this lecture, it might be wise if I summarize the positions he has formerly held. These include fellowships and lectureships at the universities of Oxford, Cambridge, Aberdeen, Edinburgh. I nearly put them in alphabetical order so that I could remember them. Pittsburgh, Lublin, and Notre Dame, Indiana, as well as Georgetown University, Princeton, and Rome's Gregorian University. Professor Haldane has published 200 academic papers, authored many books, and also writes for papers and periodicals. He is recognized internationally as a public intellectual and commentator on social and cultural issues. While in Australia, in addition to the unit that he's teaching here at the university on the topic The Good Society, Its Nature and Foundations, Professor Haldane is delivering many lectures, taking part in topical debates, appearing on ABC television, being interviewed on radio programs and within the print media. He provides an impressive model of commitment to intellectually rigorous, well-reasoned, and ethical engagement in public conversation. And he does so with grace, equanimity, and fortunately with good humor. I ask you to welcome him to the podium to deliver his lecture on the topic sex and society, which will be followed by a time for questions from the audience. Professor Haldane.
Thank you very much indeed, Sandy. It's proving a very pleasant visit. My wife and I, we've been here now, I think, 4 or 5 weeks, and it's been delightful. It became delightful again today when the clouds passed and the sun came out, so I'm hoping we're going to see more of that. But I greatly appreciate the colleagues here at the University of Notre Dame, Sandy and others, in contributing actually to making both an intellectually collegial environment, but also very charming and gracious hospitality. So for that, I'm very grateful indeed. It's evidently a Catholic occasion because you pick up your glass of wine as you come in, and I'm reminded of the line, I think it is from G.K. Chesterton, the poem in which the rolling English drunkard made the rolling English mile. But at one point he says he doesn't care where the water gets, as long as it doesn't get into the wine. So you'll see that I don't think it can be from that poem, but anyway, that he doesn't care where the water goes as long as it doesn't get into the wine. So I'm keeping the wine very far removed from the water, and I'm not going to take any risk of diluting this with a drop of water. but I will put it down. Some years ago, I remember when one of the colleges... Sorry, are you hearing me at the back? I'm sorry, are you hearing me at the back? Yes. I remember some years ago when one of the colleges of London University was celebrating, I think, perhaps a century and a half or something of that sort. It was decided by the principal of the university that it would be a good idea if this event was marked by a series of public lectures reviewing various issues of the day. And so the academics were prevailed upon to decide what they might lecture on, and there were going to be a series of, I don't know, 10 lectures or something of this sort. And some of them included things like, you know, reflections on paradoxes of voting and things of that kind, which you can imagine people weren't exactly flooding in for that one. But the British philosopher Roger Scruton decided that he was going to give as his lecture one under the title Sexual Desire. And the place was absolutely packed. Now, in thinking of a title for this evening, the title is Sex and Society, but I did at one point think of titling it The Sex Society, but then I thought that might bring in the wrong sort of crowd, so I decided against that. So it's Sex and Society, Sex and Sex. It's going to turn out there's quite a lot of sex in this lecture, but don't be disturbed. You won't have to witness any of it. I'm going to be talking about a number of issues, really to do with sex, family, society, and in some respects a slight puzzle, which is why it is that we have become so obsessed with sex. And so I will have something to say about that. I'm going at points to draw on some rather abstract considerations advanced by some famous philosophers, including Aristotle, Thomas Aquinas, and Hegel. But it will turn out that actually these central ideas of these figures can be interpreted in a fairly commonsensical way. So you won't be scratching your heads too much. As I say, the theme is sex and society, and how I'm going to proceed is I have, I think, something like a dozen projections to show you, and I'm going to just base my talk really around these. So the opening one there is, you know, just a set of covers of magazines. The news agents and bookstores are absolutely full of these kind of magazines. Now, I mean, these are not these aren't pornographic magazines, but nonetheless, you know, sex is very much a feature of them, and this is something with which we're very familiar. Let me move from that, however, to something slightly different. I'm not sure I should be pointing this, but we'll soon find. Yeah, there we go. So we're going to come back to sex, but at this point I just want to switch to family. And I'd like to contrast briefly changing understandings of family over a relatively short period of time, actually, through two rather successful American comedy series, situation comedies set in a domestic setting. And I think they've both shown here in Australia. One is Everybody Loves Raymond, and the other one is Modern Family. Can I just ask, who's seen Everybody Loves Raymond? Is that shown here? Yeah, okay, good. And Modern Family? Right, okay. So these are rather contrasting programs. They both, in one sense, have a very similar format, really. They just they concern various sort of comic episodes arising from the relationships between a group of individuals, and they both have family in the title, but there are somewhat marked differences between them as well. So Everybody Loves Raymond. Actually, one point of similarity between the two is that each of these comedy series have two scriptwriters. And in each case, the scriptwriter said that they based the narratives and many of the settings and scenes and episodes on aspects of their own experience of family. So these are both comic representations, but they're meant to be comic representations rooted in an experience of the writers. And of course, the writers assume that their experience will resonate with the experience of the audience. Everybody loves Raymond. What I've put in there is a little bit of the sort of family relationships. Actually, my slight problem is that I can't see around this screen. Yeah, here we go, right. So we've got, over here, we've got everybody loves Raymond, and the real sort of hero of this is Deborah. Deborah has to cope with a whole variety of, somebody going to move that slightly? Yeah, it actually would be, if that's possible, yeah. It's just because otherwise I'm partly guessing what I hear, but let's not take any, actually the other way of doing this, the easier way of doing this is going to move this slightly, sure. Isn't it? Yeah. Yeah. That'll be fine. Is that all right? Yeah, that's better. That's fine. Thank you very much. Good. Sorry. So the hero of all of this, Everybody Loves Raymond, is Deborah. Deborah has to put up with the idiocies, particularly of her husband, Ray, behind her, and, of course, the slightly tense relationship with her mother-in-law, Marie. But anyway, the family is a relatively simple family. We see them here, the Baron family. There's Frank, the father, slightly grumpy character. There's Marie, who's very protective of her favored son, Ray. And then there's Ray, and then his wife, Deborah. And then there's Robert, who's finally found himself a wife after some difficulties. Amy, and then Deborah and Ray have these three children, Ali, Michael, and Jeffrey. And in that respect, it's a rather traditional family. To be and by the way, look at this, its highest viewing figure for Everybody Loves Raymond is 33 million, which is a very large, that's excluding international broadcasts. Everybody Loves Raymond is on British television every day of the week, well, 5 days a week. And I don't know whether it's been popularly rebroadcast here, I imagine it has. That's to be contrasted with Modern Family. The last series of Everybody Loves Raymond was made in late 2004 and broadcast in 2005. The first series of Modern Family was broadcast only 4 years later, and it's still continuing. The latest series was filmed in 2015, is showing in 2016. Its highest viewing is 13 million, which was achieved in 2011. And if you know this program, it involves a kind of set of, I suppose the idea was sort of non-conventional relationships in a way, but it's meant to represent the modern family. There are people who've broken up from one another, they've taken up with somebody else, and this is represented here by this heart here that's been broken and then, or you know, cut through, and then this person's in a relationship with that, and then this one's in a relationship with that one who seems to have either their adopted children or they've acquired other people's children and so on. But of course there's also a gay couple here who've adopted a child here, and so this one was in some kind of relationship with somebody else over there and so on. And so this is meant to represent the reality of the modern American family, right, in which divorce, separation, taking up with other people's children, somebody finding that they're gay halfway through their life and then taking up with a male partner and then adopting a child and so on. So this is meant to be a kind of representation of modern America. What I think is interesting is that the gap between the two programs is not that great. I mean, the chronological gap between them is not that great. So it's not as if, you know, this is a... I mean, you could say that this is a depiction of America long past, but I don't think it is. I think that this is, of course, to some extent, this is celebratory and sentimental, but then this is celebratory and sentimental as well. I think this is actually part of propaganda, actually. I mean, I think this is an attempt to try to sell us in the mold of something like that, a new conception of how family should be ordered and arranged. But it's interesting in its own way. I'll come back to that. But now I return to the issue of sex. Sexual schizophrenia is the first thing I want to begin with. Currently here in Australia, but also in the United States and in Great Britain, there's a great obsession with sexual predation on children. and sexual abuse of children. And this is seen to be, you know, something utterly evil, obviously immoral, beyond contempt, really. But at the same time, the very same culture that is demonizing any sexual interest in children is promoting a sexualized image of children. So it's one and the same society that is condemnatory, rightly as I see it, condemnatory of paedophilia or anything like that, is at the same time, we start out with this slightly sort of sweet image of the, you know, the girl, she's sort of doing herself up maybe to look like a mummy or somebody she's seen on television. But then we see this kind of pose here, and by this point, you know, we're like that, and then we go into this. And the interesting thing is, at the same time as a sexual interest in young people is condemned, as it were, out of one side of our mouths, on the other side there's a whole genre of pornography, so-called barely legal pornography, that is trying to, as it were, push the boundary down to the point of legality. So here we've got, you know, it's not so very, I mean, it's almost as if there's a kind of a line, an arbitrary line, and if somebody's on one side of it, has a sexual interest on one side of that age group, then they're a paedophile and they're to be condemned. But, you know, if the birthday rings the next day, then suddenly this is the subject of legitimate pornography, the barely legal pornography. And this seems to me speaks to a kind of sexual schizophrenia, that society has disordered sense of sexuality. If on the one hand it condemns, on the other it tarts children up, and then on the other it also generates this whole genre of rather popular pornography around the of you know, the pushing the boundaries of the sexual age limit. And that already, I think, tells you something about our society, that we don't have coherent attitudes towards sex and sexuality. The fact that I think the fact that it's become, that the whole issue of paedophilia has become so prominent, so salient, so constantly before us, is, I think, actually a manifestation not of good sexual conscience, but of a bad sexual conscience. It's we're kind of offloading onto the paedophile our guilts about our own sexual prurience and interest. And that's illustrated, I think, by the fact that, you know, that this genre of pornography has developed and is so prevalent, and that this interest, this sexualization of children is so prevalent, while at the same time we're denouncing paedophiles for their interest. It's hardly surprising that there's paedophilia going on in a society that is itself already sexualizing its own children. And so the condemnation of the paedophile seems to me a kind of hypocrisy. I'm not here speaking on behalf of the paedophile. My point is the other way, that we have a bad conscience about sex and our understanding of it, and so it's become convenient to permit everything over here and then just single out some small group and, as well, make them the scapegoat of every lack of ease or bad conscience about sexuality and sex. Continuing in the theme of young people, here we have, this is just a screenshot taken from Amazon. I just went on Amazon today. And if you want to buy this book, the book is Dares to Speak, Historical and Contemporary Perspectives on Boy Love. So this is just a book you can just buy off Amazon. And it's published by a publisher called Gay Men's Press. And Gay Men Press, at the time of its publication, which was in 1997, but you can see it's got several stars there. Gay Men Press, the publisher said of the book this: Gay Men Press has always seen boy love as a legitimate strand in the gay rainbow. There are boys who love men, just as there are men who love boys. The book was reviewed in The Guardian, and the reviewer was somewhat critical of it. And in response to that, the gay rights activist Peter Tatchell, was an interesting and complex man, actually, but he wrote a letter to The Guardian taking issue to some degree with the review, the critical review, and he said this: "The distinguished psychologists and anthropologists cited in this book deserve to be heard. While it may be impossible to condone paedophilia, it's time that society acknowledged the truth that not all sex involving children is unwanted, abusive, or harmful." Let me
Let's see if we...
Sorry, I need to go back a bit. So let's just see briefly where we've got to. So we start out with this prominence of sexual imagery. I'm trying to work out, where is actually the... Is it round there? Do you know? Yeah, it's round there. I just need to... Yeah, there you go. That's it. Found my way around. And then this contrasting images of two kinds of family. Is this which is the American family now? Is it the Barones of Everybody Loves Raymond, or is it the people over here in modern family? And I mean, clearly something has happened socially and culturally that takes us from this to this. But one question I think is how deep is what's happened? What are the causes of what's happened is another question. I'll say something about that. And to what extent is this actually seeking to lead rather than to follow social trends? To what extent is this actually part of pushing that forward? And clearly, as we'll see shortly, there's a lot of, as well, pushing of the boundaries around sex and sexuality in lots of different directions. And that bears upon the question, which we'll come to shortly, of marriage, both same-sex marriage, but not only that. Because again, I think there's a kind of bad conscience about this. On the one hand, there's a sort of tendency to be transgressive, to push against traditional conceptions, but on the same time, to want the approbation that comes with the notion of marriage. So just as you have this kind of schizophrenia around the idea of the paedophile is somebody vile who's got interest in sexual relations with younger people, but at the same time, we're a culture that's sexualizing young children and also producing pornography that's designed to appeal to that appetite. At the same time, I think we're a culture or cultures that are pushing against traditional conceptions of the family and of marriage, but at the same time want the, as it were, the honorific, the validation that comes with the notion of marriage, but want to apply it to a broader and broader category of cases, and I'll talk about those. I myself actually don't think that same-sex marriage is the most significant instance of this. I'll come to a couple of others which I think in a way are more significant. And as I said, on the sexualization of the young and sexual interest in the young, this is another manifestation of it, in this case not heterosexual but homosexual. But I do think it's interesting that the publishers feel free to say that this is a legitimate strand in the gay rainbow. And as I say, that Tatchell would be willing to say that not all sex involving children is unwanted, abusive, or harmful. So you're thinking of having a baby. Congratulations, you're having a lesbian. I think this was, here in Australia, this was part of a, was this broadcast? There was a complaint about this, but I don't know if it was actually broadcast. This was part of a television, a short television commercial that was put out by a group called whataryouhaving.org. And, these are two different posters or extracts from, excerpts from commercials. One is to do with the question of thinking of having a baby. One thing that's quite interesting about this is that, I'll take these in turn. Let's start off with thinking of having a baby. One thing that's quite interesting about this is if we just take the imagery, I'm a great believer in looking at imagery, it's often quite revealing, in ways that I think people don't necessarily intend. And by the way, can I just, in order to illustrate that point, let me just go back to something. It's quite interesting if we look at this, that the Barone family are set within a natural setting. You see here there's a kind of park or landscape or something of that sort. So it's a family, as it were, set within nature. And no doubt there's rain or something of that sort. So there's usual contingencies of human life, right? Rain can fall on your barbecue or whatever else it may be. But it is interesting that it's set within this natural setting, this natural landscape setting. And an acknowledgement of, as it were, things always not going well. I mean, that's a standard theme of the whole program, Everybody Loves Raymond. It's something's always breaking down or not going well, but they come together at the end of it. Notice the setting for this, right? It's just a blank screen. It's just an artificial setting. It's a studio photograph, right? This is just a group of people standing in front of a white backdrop and so on. So it's almost as if, I'm sure they didn't intend this, but it's almost as if there is no natural setting for these people. It's an artificial setting. And maybe that's a sort of reflection to some extent of the relationships that are realized here. But on this theme of looking at the images, So if we go here, thinking of having a baby, this relates to something, I'll show you some statistics later on, but this image I think is interesting because it's clearly for this person not a certainty that they would want to have a child, right? I mean, there's some perplexity here, should I, shouldn't I? And the second thing to notice about this person is they're a little bit older. And those two features, the uncertainty as to whether or not they're going to have a child and they're being a little bit older, are significant aspects of the current social situation, in which particularly because of women's entry into the workforce and women's reasonable ambitions to have a career and so on, there is this question, do I really want to have a family? After all, having a family would be disruptive of the pattern of my work. It might set me back in the career structure and so on. Do I really want to do that? So there's a notion, there's a sort of implicit context here that the idea of having a child might be a sacrifice. It might mean derailing yourself from a course that you're already on. And so there's genuine perplexity here, and it's not clear how it's going to be resolved. Maybe the answer will be no, I don't think I will have a baby. And then in the second image, which as I say is an extract from a sort of promotional video that was made, concerned with sort of gay rights advocacy. In what we see in the video, if you view it, and you can do so online, is that it's this woman and her partner, her male partner, who are very pleased with the fact that she's pregnant, and the scan is being done, and they say, the nurse says, would you like to know what it is, i.e. a boy or a girl? And they say, yes, we would, and she says, congratulations, you're having a lesbian. The point here, by the way, is to try to, which is a legitimate point, actually, after all, is to point out that, you know, lesbians don't, as it were, just descend from heaven or arise from below. They are human beings that are born into families just like everybody else. In that sense, I think it's quite effective. But I do think it's interesting the way in which this kind of politicization or the adoption of the family and the family model into advocacy and into questions of a cultural sort. You know, do you want to have a baby? You don't have to have a baby. You're not pressured to have a baby. It's up to you. If you do have a baby, be aware that, you know, having a baby, it may be a gay baby. That's where we've got to now. This is something to be pleased about. Congratulations, and so on. I'm offering these. Now, transgenderism and marriage equality. I was talking about the pushing, as it were, against the traditional conception of marriage as monogamous, exclusive, and lifelong. I'm going to offer three examples of this. This is one, obviously, transgenderism and marriage equality. Some of you present here, well, I know at least some of you who are present here, were also present at a debate at the Sydney Recital Hall, which took place, a couple of weeks ago, I think, wasn't it now, in which I participated and three others did. There were two of us on either side of the issue. And that was broadcast last Sunday night on ABC 24. And will be repeated again on Saturday evening on ABC 24. And then we'll have a much larger television audience because it will be broadcast by BBC World. But the theme was this. It was society must recognize trans people's gender identities. And if you think that's an interesting issue, then you might enjoy the debate. But the only aspect of it, I mentioned two actually. One is interesting, which was the vote that was taken before the debate. So as people came into the hall, they were invited to indicate how they would vote, were they in favor or against societies recognizing transgender identities. And as I recall, the figure in favor was 76% in favor, 4% against, and 20% undecided. By the end of it, there'd been a 20% move in favor of against, if you didn't put it in favor of against. But interestingly, online, the voting is rather different. And I think what that tells you in part is that the hall was largely, those attending it, there was a very significant percentage of those attending it were themselves advocates of the position that they were then voting for. So, but I don't come, that's just a fact of the matter. But transgender transgender marriage is one area in which sort of traditional understandings are being probed and pushed and challenged. Another one is polyamory, multi-partner marriage. So let me just read from the Canadian Polyamory Advocacy Association. It reports that on November the 23rd, 2011, the British Columbia Supreme Court ruled that Section 293 of the Criminal Code of Canada does not apply to unformalized polyamorous relationships, so multi-partner unions. That decision was not appealed. The government chose not to appeal that. Often what happens, I'm sure this is true in Australia, it's certainly true in Britain, what you sometimes get are test cases that are brought before a senior court, say in the United States, obviously the Supreme Court, the Federal Supreme Court. And in the United Kingdom now, we have a Supreme Court as well. I don't know, what is the highest court in Australia called? Is it a Supreme Court? Does anybody know? The High Court, okay. So what you often have in these, where sort of social issues are concerned, is that a specimen case will be brought before the Supreme Court. Sometimes, or the High Court, sometimes courts will decide it's not timely to consider that case, but often when they do consider that case, it's because there's a determination on the part of the justices to resolve it in a particular direction, or because there's a feeling that it's a matter that is timely to resolve in whichever direction it may be. And so what often happens is that a case, I mean, other cases, you know, may or may not be pressed, but some particular case, specimen case, is taken. And where there may be a breach of law or an assumption of a breach of law, typically it would be the responsibility of the chief legal officer of the government, say the Attorney General or whatever the relevant office would be, to represent the state's interest in the matter, so to contest a case, for example. But where the state is not interested, where the state actually favours the case which would involve a change of law or setting law aside at any rate, it will often put up no resistance. So that's what's going on here. So on November the 23rd, 2011, the British Columbia Supreme Court ruled that Section 293 of the Criminal Code of Canada does not apply to unformalised polyamorous relationships. So somebody had wanted to say, look, people existing in polyamorous relationships violate some aspect of the law with regard to marriage in Canada. That decision was not appealed and effectively makes polyamory legal in Canada where a person is not married in a ceremony to more than two people. The question is certain kinds of legal recognition that would obtain. Don't want to go into the legal details of this. Then the Canadian Polyamory Advocacy Association seeks to promote legal, social, government, and institutional acceptance and support of polyamory and advocates the interests of the Canadian polyamorous community generally. We're here because we have a right to live with the people we love. And it's a very familiar refrain now. We have a right to live with the people we love, or sometimes analogously or relatedly put, we have a right to marriage equality. I'm going to say more about marriage equality in a minute. That's a case from Canada. Here's a case from Scotland. The convener of Atheist Scotland says in the same year, if Scotland is to be considered as a modern country which values diversity, then alternative forms of marriage, such as polygamy, should also be granted legal recognition. Polygamous marriages are illegal in Scotland and England, but those entered into overseas are not only recognised in Britain, but the social security system makes provision for their maintenance through child benefit and things of that sort. This is traditional British hypocrisy at its worst. Polygamy should be brought into the mainstream with all people in Britain free to engage in polygamous marriage with the same legal recognition and social esteem as heterosexual and soon to be gay marriage. At that point, gay marriage had not been passed in Scotland. And by the way, Scotland was the first part of the United Kingdom to pass legislation allowing gay marriage. Women, but you see, it's only back in 2011. See how things are accelerating here. Women who wish to engage in polyandry should also be free to enter into polyandrous marriage with the same parity of esteem and legal recognition as other forms of marriage. So the polygamy, polyandry, is just to do with whether it's one man with several wives or one woman with several husbands. You might wonder whether somebody's kind of put together this issue with the previous issue and other issues and argue that there should be polyamorous same-sex marriage, and the answer is yes, that is being campaigned for as well. So that was polyamory and marriage equality. Let's just go back. We had transgenderism and marriage equality, and now I want to go to incest and full marriage equality. So there is a site, full marriage equality site, so you can't really read this very clearly, but this sets out certain principles of free association and marriage, and basically the rationale of this organization, Full Marriage Equality, is that marriage should be available to any number of consenting adults. So what I mean is you could have multi-party marriage, polyamorous marriage, obviously same-sex marriage. You could have incestuous marriage between a father and a daughter. That has been the subject of a significant legal case in Germany recently. And between a mother and daughter, or between siblings, and so on. The big push currently is not for father-daughter marriage or father-son marriage and so on, but for sibling marriage. And my own prediction, for what it's worth, is that sibling marriage will be introduced in some state within the next 15 years. I think we will see sibling marriage. I think, by the way, there's no very good argument to resist sibling marriage once you depart from a traditional conception of marriage as heterosexually founded and as being one exclusive, one person, one male, one female marriage. That's why I think my concern here is not actually so much with same-sex marriage, it's to do with the notion of departures from the traditional conception of marriage. And so we're looking at several of these. So this is incest and full marriage equality. The GSA community is the genetic sexual attraction community, which the founder of the genetic sexual attraction community is a woman, I think she's Canadian, I can't remember, who actually was in a sexual relationship with, I don't know how far this developed, with her son, and looking for, and has argued that there should be legal accommodation for parent-sibling sexual relationships and indeed parent-sibling marriage. A rather prominent British journalist, Johan Hari, wrote an article in the Guardian, 2002, "Forbidden Love, Can Sex Between Close Relatives Ever Be Acceptable?" And in it he writes, "We must acknowledge that with the rise of contraception, we succeeded in separating sex from reproduction. Another unashamed participant in incest discovered in a chat room, daddy's girl, insisted we'd never have a baby. It would be all screwed up and wrong. I use the coil." And so Harry asks, "Has a window opened for safe incest? And if so, is our visceral disgust just a remnant from a vanishing age?" It's interesting. This question is rhetorical. It turned out, actually, upon investigation, that Johan Hari was himself the author of a number of pornographic, incestuous, not publications, but on blog sites and so on, kind of stories on blog sites. Strikingly, 2015, last year, Lord Lexton, who's a gay rights advocate and is historian of the Conservative Party, stood up in Parliament and said this: "Is it not the case that in Britain today, all other stable and loving couples are now able to formalize their relationships in legal terms, so vitally important where inheritance and its tax implications are concerned. If sibling couples," this is under the heading of stable and loving couples, "if sibling couples are to be denied civil partnerships, how does the government propose to address the injustice that will arise in the death of one of them, with the survivor having to sell the family home to pay inheritance and so on?" Now, this is not the case. Lexton is not making the case that some conservatives have made, social conservatives have made, in an effort to actually undermine civil partnership as a relationship provided for homosexual couples. One argument that's been made is this: "Oh, well, just let anybody have civil partnerships, because that way, as it were, it drains from them any particular significance attaching to the sexual relationships between the parties." Lord Lexon doesn't have that in mind. Lord Lexon actually does have in mind couples who are in sexual relationships who are siblings. And so just gives you a very interesting insight into how rapidly this is developing, that that's 2015 in the House of Lords, that a member of the House of Lords and the official historian of the Conservative Party should stand up and make the case, really. He was complaining about the fact that the existing relationships under civil partnership and now under marriage do not make provision for sibling civil partnership or sibling marriage. And in fact, well, I won't say any more about that. The thing I'm pointing out here is that this is that the issue of marriage. I want to come back to the question of why things in the area of sexuality have taken the direction that they have and why they've accelerated so rapidly. I want to return to that, and I think to understand that we have to look at history and at philosophy. We have to understand something of the history of the 20th century, and we also have to understand something of some philosophical ideas that have currency just now. There's an irony in the fact that those ideas, which are appropriated by radicals in pursuit of these kind of social changes, actually have their roots in bourgeois capitalism. They're very much configured around consumerism and consumer rights. My point here is that this is just evidence of the fact that, as Australia approaches the question of same-sex marriage, this really does look, from other parts of the world, as yesterday's issue, right? I mean, we've moved on, as it were. But that's why I think the question of same-sex marriage is important, not, I think, intrinsic. I mean, I think some who are resistant to same-sex marriage have in mind the particular, from their point of view, distaste for homosexual relationships. That's not my concern here at all. What I'm interested in is if you give up the traditional conception of marriage as an exclusive one man, one woman relationship and a lifelong relationship, ideally a 10-year lifelong relationship, you really do have no grounds once you go the route that is so often advocated, the marriage equality grounds, you really have no basis for resisting incestuous marriage or polyamorous marriage either. So I want to say something about the marriage equality argument in a minute. Proceeding, yeah. Now, you might say, isn't this an old story? Isn't it the case that for a long time in society, sex has been, as it were, going on, not just, sexual relationships of, within, say, something like marriage and so on, but kind of sexual license has been a feature of life, and that certainly is true. So here we have, for example, Hogarth, part of the Rake's Progress, a set of well-known set of paintings, now housed in the John Soane's Museum in the Lincoln's Inn, the legal area of London. But here we have William Beckford and William Courtney, who was the third Earl of Devon. William Beckford was a very, he inherited a vast fortune in the 18th century, and he was a very influential figure in the development of kind of a neo-Gothic architectural style, not as an architect, but as a patron commissioning things. But this chap here, who became the third Earl of Devon, he first established a relationship with this fellow when he was 10. So it was a 10-year-old boy, and their relationship developed. It led eventually, when this chap's father discovered the relationship, in due course it actually led to effectively both of them being exiled, both of them leaving, voluntary exile, getting out of the country. But there's nothing new about man-boy love, right? And there's nothing new about sexual license and so on. I mean, here we have, as it were, closer to home within the context of a Catholic institution. This is the dramatization of the life of the Borgias. And that seems to involve just about every relationship that was possible. So in one sense, it's an old story, but I'm going to suggest there's another sense in which it's a new story, that the attitude to sex and sexuality that has developed over the last, say, 30 years particularly, really does mark something new in society. And one way of seeing this, actually, is that all of these images here, or all of these cases that I'm just sort of presenting, I mean, obviously many more one could present, but are all ones that then secured stigmatization, right? They're ones from which society recoiled, right? The whole point about the rake's progress in Hogarth is this is meant to demonstrate, as it were, a decline into an abandonment of order, right? This is the whole point. I mean, he ends up syphilitic and various other things and so on. But the point is that this is an illustration of, there's an element of titillation, but it's not a celebration of this. It's an implied condemnation of this, right? The rake's progress. I mean, it's a descent. In fact, there's a sort of ironic play on the idea of a progress. It really is a descent. And of course, if you know that series of paintings, the rake ends in bedlam, mad, probably driven mad by syphilis, but at any rate. And then the story of Beckford and the third Earl of Devon is, in its own time, was a scandalous tale. And then, of course, the Borgias we know about because they're meant to be a sort of epitome or a paradigm of a certain kind of scandalousness of the high, of the Renaissance period. So in one sense, it's an old story, sex driving people mad. But in other ways, I think there are aspects of our situation that are a new one and which have, I think, rather significant implications for family and for society. Now, the background argument that I think has been used by advocates of new forms of relationship and the validation and recognition of those new forms of relationship is a kind of argument to which I've given the title in print on another occasion, argumentum ad consummationem. That's to say, it's an argument to consummation. And here's the argument, and it's in some respects quite a simple, well, certainly a simple argument, and in some respects an appealing argument. It's just this: sexual attraction and love are determinants of human happiness and should be consummated wherever sincerely felt. That's the first premise. You can't choose to whom you're sexually attracted, and you can't choose with whom you fall in love. That seems kind of reasonable, right? And so therefore, whether or not they're chosen, attraction and love should be consummated where sincerely felt. Right? Now, I think this argument, and not explicitly set out in that form, but is actually quite pervasive in our society. And I think for two reasons. One is it's a highly sexualized society. It's a society for which the notion of sex has displaced the notion of personal meaning. Right? In an earlier age, people's attempt to try to situate themselves and find fulfillment in their lives was around notions of meaning or significance in life. For our culture, for our society, that has been displaced by the idea of sexual fulfillment and sexual authenticity, and so on. So I think that one thing that makes this argument seem very appealing is that, as I say, the notion of sexual fulfillment has come for us to occupy the place that the notion of discovering meaning in your life had for earlier generations. The second thing is that we're a rampantly sentimental society. Rampantly sentimental. I mean, everybody loves Raymond as an expression of that sentimentalism, and so indeed is Modern Family. But we're a rampantly sentimental society. In another context, I think this was actually in the transgender debate, so this is, I think this is actually captured for television, I point out that it was characteristic. It's interesting if you just look at debates, actually look at texts of debates, transcripts of debates, all the way through until relatively recently, in which parties in those debates on either side would say things like, I disagree with you, and here are my reasons. Right? Now what people say is, I find that very upsetting, or I feel so-and-so, or let me tell you about my experience, or here's how I feel, or that's very offensive, or I find that hurtful. Notice none of those expressions has got anything to do with reason at all, right? So the mode of argument now is not, here's an argument, right, here are three reasons and so on. It's, if you say that, that upsets me, that makes me feel marginalized, that offends me, or whatever else it may be. This is an aspect, and ironically an aspect in the context where reason is meant to be what's at issue, of the kind of rampant sentimentalization, and indeed, I think, infantilization. People don't want to be confronted by arguments because they might upset them. If the conclusion runs counter to what they think, that's not something they're comfortable with. And of course, that's another notion. I'm not comfortable with that, right? Doesn't, what's it, is it true? Why do it's true? I'm just not comfortable with it, right? Well, not for your comfort, I think is the answer to that. So I think it's that, on the one hand, this displacement of the notion of personal meaning by the idea of sexual fulfillment, on the one hand, and a displacement of the notion of reason by the notion of sentiment on the other, that I think makes this kind of argument seem very appealing, right? Sexual attraction loves are determinants of human happiness, right? That's the displacement of meaning. It's not meaning as a determinant of human happiness. It's these. It's not just that they're determinants, but I mean that they're elements, but they are determinants. And should be consummated where sincerely felt. Notice felt. You can't choose to whom you're sexually attracted. You can't choose with whom you fall in love. It's not obvious this is true, by the way, but anyway, whether or not they're chosen, attraction and love should be consummated wherever sincerely felt. Now, the point I want to make is this. Consider that argument, if you're tempted by that argument, now consider it in connection with the claims of full marriage equality in application to same-sex, transgender, polyamory, genetic attraction, and combinations of the foregoing, right? So transgender, polyamorous, incestuous marriage, for example. Right? Now, you just have to test this for your own case. I mean, do you feel that you really want to say that, you know, sexual attraction and determinants of human habits should be consummated even where the case is one of, say, father-son relationships and so on and such like? It seems to me, as you consider these particular examples, whichever one is what strikes you as most pointed, it gives you reason to revisit this argument and wonder whether there isn't actually something wrong with this argument. In fact, I think there's quite a lot wrong with this argument. In particular, we really want to focus on these notions of determinants, what the notion of love is that's playing here, what it means to be a determinant, what's understood by human happiness, what about sincere feeling, and so on. So consider the premises and do some serious philosophical thinking. So, quick bit of serious philosophical thinking. I'll have to be quick. I'm just going to turn very quickly here to three figures from different periods: Aristotle from the ancient world, Aquinas from the Middle Ages, and Wittgenstein from the 20th century. Now, and what you see here is somebody playing flute on on a dolphin, right? There's Aristotle, a little depiction of Aristotle in a 13th century manuscript. There's Thomas Aquinas, and there's Wittgenstein. Now, Aristotle, this is apropos the question of marriage equality. Aristotle, famously in the Politics, which is, you know, one of the most important founding works of political philosophy. In the Politics, he discusses the notion of equality. Equality not in terms of physical measurement and things being of the same size and so on, but equality in terms of justice, equality as between people. And he says this: it is thought by all men that justice is some sort of equality. And they hold that for persons that are equal, the thing must be equal. But equality in what characteristic does this mean, and equality in what? Equality with respect to what? If one is distributing flutes, they should not be given to everyone, but to those who can play them. Right? The point is, if you're distributing some asset, and actually the status of marriage is a social asset, if you're distributing that, if somebody says, well, equality means everybody should get it, the answer to that is, no, we're distributing an asset. You treat like cases alike, right? Now, if you take the principle that you treat like cases alike, which is Aristotle's principle, then that permits you to treat unlike cases differently. And obviously what one's going to say about this is that, of course, the notion of marriage equality equivocates between these two ideas, treating everybody in the same way and treating like cases in the same way. And what has to be shown there, therefore, by the advocates of non traditional marriage is that the cases that they're advocating are in the relevant respects like. And that's actually quite difficult to do. So the challenge really, this expression marriage equality is just a very glib, empty, vacuous, light-headed idea. What actually needs to be substantiated and articulated by philosophical argument. And the obvious counter to it is that equality involves treating like cases alike. And so unlike cases have to make the argument. I'm not saying that argument can't be made. I'm just saying, as it were, it resides on that side to make that argument. Now, secondly, in another work, the De Anima, on the principles of life, I've lost the W from we here, what Aristotle does in this is talk about different kinds of living beings and so on. And basically, the position he ends up with is this. He says that we can classify living things according to different characteristics, reproduction, sentience, appetite, motion, imagination, memory, will, reason, and so on. And then he tells us that different kinds of living things are distinguishable by basic vital characteristics. So plants, for example, are distinguishable from the fact of nutrition, growth, and reproduction, but not sentience. They don't have feeling, they don't have appetite, they don't move around, and so on, at least not on their own account. And then the point is that these things are ordered hierarchically. And what that means is this. If you look at all the living things there are, all the different kinds of animal species that there are, you'll find that some animal species only have nutrition, growth, and reproduction, but you won't find any animal species that doesn't have those. So there will be some animal species that have feeling, appetite, and motion. But anything that has feeling, appetite, and motion also has nutrition, growth, and reproduction, but not vice versa. And anything that has imagination, memory, and will have sentience, appetite, and motion, and nutrition, and growth, and reproduction, but not necessarily vice versa, and so on. So what we get here is the notion of a hierarchy of different kinds of animals. And now the thing is, you have to look at what the vital characteristics are of animals. And among them are reproduction, right? One of the things that makes us the kind of beings we are reproduction. Now, when one tries to sort of give an account of the nature of human sexuality in terms of this animal nature, one reply to that is, oh, this is biologism. This is reducing sex to biology. And surely in human beings, sex is more than biology. Sexual interest is more than biology. And the answer to that is indeed it is. But here's where Aquinas helps us. In his commentary on Aristotle, but also in this work here, he says this, both in men, and none of this, by the way, rests on any religious assumptions whatsoever. This is not Aquinas as a theologian, this is Aquinas as a philosopher. Both in men and in other animals, where a more perfect form supervenes, I'll read it and I'll explain it, the previous form is replaced, yet so that the supervening form contains the perfection of the previous form and something in addition. Thereby we arrive at the ultimate nature, both in human beings and other animals. We conclude, therefore, that the principle of rational life is at the same time sensitive and nutritive, the pre-existing forms being replaced. Now, what's he saying there? Well, he's saying something that Wittgenstein very interestingly discusses in his philosophical writings, and it's this. That as you ascend up life forms, what happens is that the kind of form of life that exists at a lower level is subsumed but not negated in a higher order. So let me illustrate this. It is true that cats and dogs and human beings eat and digest and grow in one thing and another. But the process, the activity and the process of eating, digestion, and so on, is transformed in the human by reason. So what we do is, it's not that, as it were, that rational life negates nutrition, eating, and so on. It's that it orders it in a new way. And so what Aristotle is saying in one way, and what Aquinas is saying in another way, and what Wittgenstein again says in yet another way, is we remain animals all the way up, but what happens is that the mode of our animality is transformed by reason, culture, and so on. But nothing at the level of reason and culture negates the animal nature. So if we're going to try to understand sex, it is still, as it were, the biological character of sex that rises and, as it were, is transformed and made, is caught just like eating. You know, people dine, they diet and one thing and another. So in the case of sex, it may be regulated through the life of reason, but it's not negated in its original nature. And the original nature of sex in human animals is to do with, primarily, coupling, reproduction, and the raising of families. And so again, what I'm suggesting here is that philosophy favors what you might call the traditional conception of sex and sexuality. Now, moving forward, what happened to explain how we got from Everybody Loves Raymond to the modern family? And by the way, the feature of the modern family that I'm interested in the gay couple in this. I mean, it's just the whole picture of the transformed family, in which the traditional conception of marriage as being between one man and one woman in lifelong and exclusive union is completely broken. How did we get from this to that? And what are the consequences for society of having of that change having occurred? Well, I'll say something briefly about the consequences. Let me just say something how we got here. I think we got here through the process that really began with the Franco-Prussian War and continued with the First World War and then continued with the Second World War. What happened over that period was the emergence into history of a new phenomenon, which was large-scale warfare, multinational, multi-state, large-scale warfare. And, of course, partly that served as all social changes served by technology, with the transformations of technology. Because of increasing the size of artillery, the caliber of artillery, and also the capacity of guns to fire at great distance and so on, the nature and the development of high explosives, the nature of warfare was transformed and a new kind of barbarism overtook it. It became increasingly possible to kill larger and larger numbers of people at remote distance. So an element of kind of disassociation began to enter in. But also, one of the results of this was the direct attack on large scale on non-combatants. So the distinction between, as it were, the innocent and the guilty started to be, or the combatant participant started to be broken down. And then you start to get bombing from aircraft, which in its first, actually with the Zeppelin originally, but when in its first occurrence was deemed utterly barbarous. The idea that German Zeppelin would bomb London was seemed utterly barbarous, beyond any rules of war. But then what the First World War did was destroy the fabric of those societies, not only British society, but the Allies in that war, but also the enemy as well. And by the time you get to the Second World War, this kind of barbarism is let loose. And so you get a new kind of destructive appetite that has entered in, of course, with nuclear weapons yet again and so on. And I think that one thing that this has done is coarsen us and also remove us from the sense of the intimacy of personal relations into a kind of situation in which, to look back at the period between the two world wars, there was a kind of displacement of any hope and a replacement of it with a kind of appetite for distraction. And it's no accident, I think, that the first very significant social changes occur in the period between the Franco-Prussian World War and the First World War, and then again between the First World War and the Second World War. Remember, this is the period in which, these are the periods in which the growth of large-scale consumption of alcohol, I mean, centrally manufactured alcohol and so on, drugs and such like, and of course the whole sort of flapper culture of the interwar period. And then in the period after the Second World War, what happens? But basically, the world goes on party, right? I mean, they've just had relentless experience by this point of almost a century of developing large-scale war, leaving people with no hope and indeed the fear of complete annihilation. And I think this induces, and of course it breaks up families, men who've been off at war, many have killed or maimed. If they're not killed or maimed, they're psychologically incapable of forming settled relationships and so on. And you start to get the breakup of the family, and you start to get, as it were, the rise of what becomes much more prominent in the 1960s and 70s, which is a casualization of sex. And then sex is becoming the focus of rights and entitlement. Nobody used the language of rights in relation to sex prior to the 1960s. It's suddenly the appropriation, interestingly, out of the language of consumer rights into the domain of personal relationships. And I think it's a significant feature of this that the whole power of the American advertising industry sort of starts to drive sexual imagery into advertising, from which it had been largely absent before. Now, what are the consequences of this? Very quickly, and I'm going to conclude. This is just one feature of the changes that are going on. There's an awful lot one could point to, but this is just, I just want to pick out one thing. This is ex-nuptial births, i.e. births outside marriage. In Australia, in 1965, 5% of births were outside marriage. By 1980, it was 13%. By 2000, it's 30%. By 2010, it's 34%. We don't have the statistics for 2015 yet. In the United Kingdom, it's 8%, 11%, 40%, 43%, 47%. In the United States, 5%, 23%, 36%, 41%, 40%. It kind of bubbles along with that. Among whites, 4, 9, 23, 29, 29. Among Hispanics, this is a very interesting one because people think of the Hispanicization of the United States as introducing a socially conservative element. I think if that's your hope, forget it. Because what happens, what do we see here? 23%, 42%, 53%, 53%. And then, of course, the figure that generally doesn't come as a surprise, African Americans, 57%, 66%, 72%, 71%. 50% of US children are in homes where their fathers do not reside. It's a very striking figure, isn't it? 50% of US children are in homes where their father does not reside. That's either because there isn't a father or the father is living somewhere else. 50%. 30% of US teenage girls are pregnant at least once, and a third of those have abortions. Some, of course, have multiple pregnancies. The New York Times, which is by no means a sort of conservative organ, had a long front page article in 2013. Researchers have consistently found that children born outside marriage face elevated risks of falling into poverty, failing in school, and suffering from emotional and behavioral problems. The kind of breakdown of the family and the reorganization of the family into other entities that call themselves families and so on, new social entities, does have consequences. These pathologies include lower incomes, greater welfare dependency, domestic abuse, underperformance, behavior disorders, school and college dropout, addictions, and unemployment. Just going to end with this. Quotations, one from a work called The Institutions of the Laws of Scotland, which was an enormously influential work, not only in Scotland, but across Europe, by Dalrymple Viscount Stair. In 1681, he writes as follows. He's, by the way, is drawing very heavily from Cicero in the De Re Publica, a work of classical Rome. He says, obligations arising from voluntary engagement take their rule and substance from the will of man and may be framed and composed at his pleasure. So what he's talking about is voluntary associations, voluntary agreements are up to us. Right? Voluntary engagement take their rule and substance from the will of man and may be framed and composed at his pleasure. But not so marriage, wherein it is not in the power of the parties, though of common consent, to alter any substantial. It's not up to the parties to change the terms of marriage. Marriage arises, says Stair, from the law of nature, and it is given as the very example of the natural law. And the interesting thing about this is this appears on page one of the Institutes of the Laws of Scotland. Marriage is taken as the prime example of a natural law arrangement, a non-conventional, non-voluntary form of arrangement. It's something that is an expression of human nature. And then, you know, in the 19th century, early part of the 19th century, I was trying to do the math, 140 years later, Hegel, in his philosophy of rights, says this, and I think this is, I read it, interpret it, and stop. The family, says Hegel, as the immediate, again, I have to read these things and then explain them, right? The family as the immediate substantiality of spirit, he just means human consciousness. So the family as the immediate expression of human consciousness is particularly characterized by love, which is that spirit's feeling of its own unity, its human consciousness feeling of its own unity. It comes to a sense of its own unity in the complementarity where male and female come together in the production of a family. So there's a sort of completion of what is otherwise a part, right? These are incomplete parts. Male is an incomplete part of the human. Female is an incomplete part of the human. The human is completed in the union of male and female and in the natural expression of that union, which is the having of children. And so the family is an organic natural expression of human of human nature. So the family as the immediate substantiality of human consciousness is characterized by love, which is that spirit's feeling of its own unity. Hence, in a family, one's frame of mind is to have self-consciousness of one's individuality within this unity. So one comes to one's sense of oneself as an individual within the context of the unity of the family. One's real and as expressing one's real nature as a social being, with the result that one is not in it as an independent person, but as a member. The right which the individual enjoys in the strength of the family unity takes on the form of right, of entitlement, right, only when the family begins to dissolve. And I think Hegel in 1820 brilliantly and prophetically sees a direction in which culture is moving. That actually what happens is that individuals assert a right outside of the context of the family, and then having asserted that right outside of the context of the family, re-express their individualism in the idea of marriage or personal relationships as voluntary associations up to them to determine the conditions and terms of. So I think we see, putting together Steyr on the one hand and Hegel on the other, I think we see a very significant philosophical transition that has taken place, as well as the historical one I've mentioned more recently, that actually partly explains why we end up where we are today. And here's a final illustration of where we are today and where more of us might be in the future. And it's that. So these are disaggregated, as it were, individuals. In one sense, they form some kind of social group. They're hanging around together, but everybody's off having their own communication. And then the increasingly sexualized version of that brings us to that not too happy scene, I think. So thank you very much indeed. Yes, of course. Yes, indeed.
Thank you very much, John. And I think we might move straight on to some questions because we're aiming to finish sort of very close to 8 o'clock. So could I ask if there are any questions from the floor?
Or observations or objections, yes.
Or observations or objections, yes.
Just apropos your point about warfare, I was curious. The Boer War, which is seldom taught in the West.
The Boer War.
Boer War. Yeah. That was the first usage of concentration camps against the civilian population.
Yeah.
And the South Africans are often pointing out that 30,000 women and children died in that.
Yes.
Given the timing of it as preceding the First World War, what do you have any comments on that?
One of the things about, yes, I visited South Africa and visited some, I mean, have an interest in that history. And of course, as you probably know, there were people in the UK at the time, and no doubt elsewhere, who actually took the side of the Boers. Again, one of them was G.K. Chesterton. Actually, Chesterton was on the side of the Boers against the British imperial interest. I think one thing one has to say is one has to just be a little bit careful in reading back into the use of the term concentration camp, the later legacy of the Second World War and the death camps. They were called concentration camps. I mean, I'm not sort of approving or endorsing them. I just want to, before I say something more about it, just say this. Why they were called concentration camps, because what they were mass camps. I mean, there were places into which people were, you know, civilian populations were sort of pushed, right? As the progress of the war went on, these people were partly wanted to get them off the land because you were trying to sort of, well, you were going to, I mean, the whole point was to sort of disappropriate them of their land and so on. But so they were concentration camps in the sense that they were sort of mass holding camps and things of that kind. Not concentration camps in the sense that they were death camps as it emerges later in the period of the Second World War. But having said that, yes, there was a brutalization. I mean, I think that what you know, the 19th century brings us is mass warfare and mass brutalization of civilians. When you get to, and then of course, what it then produces is, of course, is the slaughter of the male population in countries like Britain and so on. I mean, remember, you know, Britain lost its leadership class through the First World War, you know. And not only Britain, I mean, that would be true of other countries. But the scale of destruction in the First World War, it's not just the fatalities, both military and civilian, it's the woundings, but also the psychological damage that's done. And now, of course, we have the whole language to characterize these kind of syndromes of psychological, you know, problems coming out of things like the Gulf War and our experience of these things. But it's the brutalization of the culture, which I think sees as its inverse a kind of brutalization of the sexual relationship, or as it were, the disengaging of the sexual relationship from the context of trusted lifelong affection, because there isn't the possibility of trusted lifelong affection. Sorry, I saw another hand somewhere. Yeah.
Thank you very much for your lecture, Professor. The basic argument that you gave tonight in favour of retaining the traditional definition of marriage was that it acts as a sort of bulwark against a whole bunch of other types of relationship that suddenly become viable or not illegitimate once we move away from that traditional definition. So I use that argument to retain the original definition, and the other person who I'm talking to says, and what's wrong with all those other things?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
What do I say next?
Well, can I just say the first part of that I wouldn't quite agree with. It wasn't that my argument for the traditional conception of marriage is if you give up that, then you've got all this other stuff, right? I mean, I think the traditional conception of marriage is an expression of our animal nature, transformed at the level of reason and so on. And I talked about, towards the end, about the naturalness of marriage, and that's connected with Hegel, actually. The naturalness of marriage as a realization at the level of the cultural of the complementarity of the parts of the human animal at the level of the biological. So I think there's a lot to be said for that conception of marriage in and on its own right, and that, you know, that could be presented at any time. My point about the and then you've picked up the point, which is that once you depart from that on the basis of the kind of argument I gave, the argumentum ad consummationem argument, right? Once you depart from traditional conception, you really have no block on the idea of incestuous marriage or polyamorous marriage or whatever else it may be. Because as long as people freely consent to engage in an erotic sentimental relationship, then why would you privilege one of these over another and so on? Now, I mean, I said something by way of an answer to that, which is that you treat like cases alike and these aren't like cases. So that's part of the answer, right? The principle of equality is not treat all cases the same, it's treat relevantly similar cases in relevantly similar ways. So it's really for the advocate of something that is unalike to show that, in fact, in some relevant way, it is alike. And the only way they can do that is at the level of the erotic, the erotic and the sentimental, because it clearly isn't the case at the level of the nature, as it were, the biological nature and so on. But I think you can run it the other way. And in fact, that's why I said my prediction is that it will effectively in policy be run the other way. At the time of when the same-sex debate was going on in the United Kingdom, I was invited to prepare something, a short sort of statement that was a sort of question really to the Prime Minister. And it's worth saying the Prime Minister didn't trouble to answer that question. But it was pretty clear that as far as the Deputy Prime Minister was concerned, he himself, I mean, I don't want to put words into his mouth, but wasn't clear that there were objections to sibling marriage, for example. But just the feeling was that, you know, we're not there yet. So, you know, but you know, when the, let's take one thing at a time, as it were. So I suspect it will happen, yeah. And as I say, if you embrace another conception of the grounds of these kind of relationship, which is erotic and sentimental, then it seems to me there's no good reason. Sometimes people say, well, surely against incestuous marriage or civil partnership, well, let's say marriage, you've got the question of, you know, congenital abnormality and things of that sort. But actually, first of all, you know, there's contraception. But also the more significant case, because again, there's no block to this, is same-sex incestuous marriage, where this isn't going to be an issue, right? So father-son marriage, or brother-brother marriage, or mother-daughter marriage, or sister-sister marriage. So, there you go. two or three people, I think, yes. There's a lady there, there's a gentleman here, there's a gentleman there. I think.
Hi.
Oh, Professor, where's that Haldane coming from? Can I see where that's coming? Yeah, sorry, yeah. Thank you.
So, you gave this kind of, you seem to endorse this kind of argument that's pretty notorious, I think. It's a sort of slippery slope argument from same-sex marriage to, for example, permissibility of incestuous marriage. So I wanted to see, here's one response to that kind of argument. I'm curious what you think about it. So I think in the course of giving that argument, you saddled the proponent of same-sex marriage with something like the following animating principle. It's like the principle, I should be able to marry whoever I want, okay? And you could see how if that's the animating principle, what's the objection to permitting incestuous marriage if that's who I want to want, if that's who I want to marry, excuse me. But likewise, if that were really the animating principle of the proponent of same-sex marriage, presumably the animating principle of the proponent of traditional marriage would be, like cases alike, something like, I should be able to marry whoever I want, provided it's someone of the opposite sex. But that principle too, if the former principle, animating gay same-sex marriage, entails the permissibility of incestuous marriage, so too does this principle entail the permissibility of one form of incestuous marriage, different sex incestuous marriage. So since you want to reject that conclusion, presumably you can't
won't be that principle.
Coherently
endorse it won't be that
saddle.
Principle.
Okay.
It won't be that principle, yeah. By the way, I mean, I'm going to reply to that, but can I just say something? I myself am more interested in accounts and defenses of the traditional conception of marriage than I am in opposing some particular case. So I think historically the same-sex one has come up first, right? And we could see why that might be, but there is a degree of contingency about that. And in fact, some advocates of incestuous marriage or incestuous civil union and so on, very often point to anthropological cases in which they try to point to other societies in which that's been a feature. And I don't know, but it'd be an interesting bit of work to do. You could easily imagine some other cultures in which there is a practice of incestuous marriage, but not a well-developed practice or not an accepted practice of homosexual relationship. So I think there is a degree of contingency. I mean, I think it's got an historical explanation. It's understandable why it may have arisen. But to some extent, I feel not discomforted by, but I don't want to focus on the case of same-sex marriage because I'm not that interested. That's not the one. It's not that this is not motivated by opposition to same-sex marriage, so let's kind of get the story going. It's more that I'm interested in trying to articulate what the nature of marriage itself is, not merely as a legal union, right, but as a kind of expression of human nature or something of that sort. So I agree with you. I mean, it wouldn't just be that the second principle that you gave, right? By the way, I don't think it's a voluntaristic, I don't think it's a will-based argument at all, right? So I don't think as well the grounds for marriage are what people want to do. I don't mean by that people should be coerced into something, right? The consent is clearly a significant element in this. But I don't think consent, as it were, is the foundation of the notion of marriage, right? I think that's a very modern 19th century notion, right? Which is the social historians have had a lot.
Legal marriage?
Especially of legal marriage, actually. Yeah, the notion of consent becomes a very salient feature in 19th century debates because of questions of validation, right, and questions of legal entitlement. And the question of dissolution, for example, of marriage, becomes a very salient feature because one of the strongest grounds for annulment or dissolution was to show that there hadn't been consent there in the first instance. So this becomes a kind of focus of that. But no, I think the ground of traditional marriage is, as I started to indicate here, it's not so much a question of, sexual attraction is obviously an aspect of it, but not just at the level of, as it were, phenomenal felt attraction, but at the sense of that attraction being an expression of something more fundamental, which is one's sexual nature, right? So I think that what comes to consciousness at the level of thought, or at the level of feeling and so on, is an expression of something more fundamental, which is the kind of being that one is. And so here's what I say about male and female, is that the complementarity of male and female is something unique and distinctive, right? That this is an expression, a recognized expression, of the fact that one is male standing in relation to that which is female. So the kind of relationship of the otherness, but it's not an alien otherness, it's a completing otherness, is at the heart of the notion of sexual desire, or the fundamental notion of sexual desire, not the idea of, felt attraction, as it were, that notion of just erotic attraction. I think erotic attraction is an interesting phenomenon, but I think it's a relatively superficial phenomenon. And there's a lot of contingency in it, as we see, right? Some people's erotic attachments go off in all sorts of different directions. So it's not, you know, I should be free to form a sexual relationship with anybody of a different sex to me, subject to the following conditions. It's rather the notion of marriage is sort of antecedent to what the individual feels. It's an expression of their nature, or it's a social institution that gives expression to the recognition of that nature. So that's it's a more, as it were, metaphysical conception of marriage, you might say. Does that at any rate make clear? I mean, you might not agree with it, but does that make a bit clearer where I'm coming from?
I disagree with every part of it.
Well, that's fine. Yeah. Disagree is good. As long as you'd said, I feel bad about what you just said.
Actually, my question is sort of about that over here. I was really interested in what you had to say about the sentimentality of these debates. That people really often speak as though my feelings are so self-evidently aligned with reality that, you know, people don't even use arguments, especially. But I was wondering if, because people on the conservative side of these debates often want to appeal to feelings as well. And I can't remember who it is that said that we ignore our feelings at our ethical peril, that, you know, often in relation to abortion or euthanasia or incest, we want to say, oh, you feel queasy about something.
Yeah.
Maybe that points to something real. So I'm wondering, what's the proper place for feelings in these debates?
Yeah, I think it's a very good question. I think it's a very difficult question to answer. Because of the the nature of the kind of world that we now inhabit is one in which, I mean, this is all very obvious in a way, but the scale of kind of, well, not just information, but media communicated effect, let's just put it that way, is all pervasive, right? And I do think that, first of all, the notion of feeling is ambiguous between the actual physical notion of feeling. So sometimes when people say, I'm disgusted, or I'm revolted by that, they're using that in a sort of semi-metaphorical way, but maybe more than that, to say, I actually feel physically sick at the contemplation of that. So there's that notion of, as it were, physical revulsion. One's whole body is, you know, repelling against this very thing. Then there's the notion of, as it were, a feeling of disgust. It is not a physical feeling, but some kind of repugnance at the very idea, whatever else it may be. And then there are these kind of cultural transformations of that. So people use the language of feeling, although they don't actually feel anything, it's become the currency of talk, right? That's what I said, where people say, I'm offended often, or, you know, I find that hurtful, or whatever else it may be. That's just often part of the language that is in which these things are discussed. It's not that people actually could find within themselves particular. They may or may not. And I do think it's very complicated now, because, I mean, to put it at its briefest, I'd be inclined to say I would be wary of invocations of feeling in the sense in which I think you have it, as it's often said, you know, this queasiness I feel about this and so on, because it's legitimate to ask questions about that. That's not to say that the queasiness might not be well-founded, but from the mere fact that one has a feeling, I think that has to be tested by way of a judgment. Not a judgment one may oneself be able to make, but somebody can articulate that and give an intelligible account of this, then I think that becomes, I think that has a weight and a suasion. But merely at the level of feeling, I'm suspicious of that. Is that? I'm just conscious we want to give,
very briefly. Yeah. So do you think it's legitimate to find common ground in feelings to make an argument to say, oh, well, you're opposed to incest, let's think about that, you know? Is that a legitimate way to make
well,
an argument?
Well, I don't know. I mean, nothing that I've said at this point, in any of this, actually was meant to invoke any feelings of repugnance or disgust or queasiness at all, right? I think it's worth asking oneself the question, if one thinks that incestuate, not everybody does think this, right? It's obviously not, because I wouldn't be discussing these other people if it weren't opposition. Not everybody does feel that it's repugnant, right? So the question is going to be of a different sort. I mean, if it's not a question of repugnance, if somebody's got resistance, why is that? Or in the case of polyamorous relationships and so on. What's the problem one feels there? People are less likely to feel that in the case of polyamorous relationships, by the way. Sorry, I think this gentleman's been waiting, yeah.
My question is, in we have examples of other cultures, thank you, both in the past and in the present day, of the legalization of non-traditional marriage, traditional in our sense, such as polygamy. In the Roman nobility and in the Middle Ages, marriage with children and things like that. Do you know of any examples from history or from other cultures of the legalization of same-sex marriage?
Well, I think the answer to that is no, but I wouldn't want to attach too much significance to my inability to come up with it. It sounds as if it's a rhetorical question, in other words, suggesting that it never has happened. Can I just say, this partly was in reference to a gentleman who asked me a question earlier on. I do think there are complications about the notion of marriage, because that has undergone various transformations. My concern here is about the notion of marriage, and I don't just think of marriage as a kind of legal contract. Okay, so I do want to draw a distinction here between marriage and civil partnership. I think, by the way, there's a better argument for civil partnerships, same-sex civil partnership, than there is for same-sex marriage. We could go down that road. But just in terms of, say, access to property and certain reciprocal legal rights and recognitions and so on. But as regards the question, I mean, I just don't know the answer to that, to be honest. I mean, the fact that I'm not coming up with a good example may actually be grist to your mill, I suspect.
It wasn't actually rhetorical.
Yeah.
I was trained myself as a historian.
Yes.
And I haven't found any examples. Yeah.
There's a book by Unwin, 1934, a book by Unwin on where he I've forgotten what his title is, UNWIN, 1934, in which he did a historical study, and basically he claims that he couldn't find any case in which a civilization had departed from what you might call, traditional sexual disciplines and stigmatization of violation of that and so on any significant scale and survived. He also connects it with things like economic decline as well, which is an interesting case in point. Thank you.
Could I ask Peter Vanderbilt to come and give a vote of thanks? And while Peter's coming up, I'll just remind you that next Wednesday night, John will be in conversation with Patrick Langrill. We'll be having a Q&A evening, so we'd invite you to come along to that. Peter, please, thank you.
Thanks very much, Sandy. Well, I'll try and keep this short. Ladies and gentlemen, it really is my pleasure and a real privilege to offer an expression of thanks to John. Now, I speak on behalf of the Order of Malta, and for some of you who aren't familiar with what we do, we are an association with the Institute of Ethics and Society at the university. And I especially want to thank Sandy for all the hard work that she's done and her people have done. Now, before I thank John formally, just a word or two about the Order. We were founded about 900 years ago. It's an international order of lay men and women. We were established with the specific dual missions of caring for the sick and the poor, and to work in the defense of the faith. And it's in the context of defense of the faith that we've been honored that this evening by John Haldane has been a stimulating and inspiring address, really, and somewhat frightening in some aspects, I found. And the relevance of his topic is extremely pertinent at a time when many people seek to question the continuing role of the Catholic faith, and indeed, at a time when many are campaigning to challenge key foundations of our society. Now, John's talk has been a very valuable contribution to equipping ordinary Catholics and our broader community with some knowledge and arguments to defend our beliefs, and of particular concern to all of us should be the very active campaign to destroy the concept of natural marriage, which will be the subject of a plebiscite shortly after the next federal election. And I'd like to take this opportunity to endorse the work of Marriage Alliance, and we have some members of that here, and there's some information outside the back door. And Marriage Alliance is actively supported by Catholics, and the Order of Malta is one of the supporters, and most other Christian churches and most other major faiths. So anyone able to support Marriage Alliance is encouraged to do so, and if you want to pick up some information about that, you can do so later. Also, colleagues of mine at the back of the hall are able to distribute some information about the order and our work to anyone who has some interest. So, John, thank you very much indeed for your scholarship and your ability to deliver such a stimulating address. Certainly has raised my concerns about all sorts of things, and I think that collectively many of us have got a great deal of work to do in the present context of what's on. And I look forward very much indeed, and I think all of us would look forward very much indeed to your next lecture for us, which is May the 12th, on the challenge of barbarianism and how to deal with it. It's the how to deal with it that I think I'll find most interesting. Now please join me in showing your appreciation.
Thank you, ladies.